things to drop off there at the lectern. Good morning. It is wonderful being with you this morning on this beautiful, brisk, cool morning. And I noticed that the sun is getting up a little bit earlier these days. So I think the days are getting just a wee bit longer, which is actually really nice. Just want to call your attention to a few things. Do pick up those calendars that we're creating in the office that gives you the opportunity to see what is up and coming and what's kind of going on in our church family and throughout the week and throughout the month. And so those come out at the first of every month, but we just want to make sure we can get information into your hands and you can take those home, put them on your fridge or whatever. I use mine, we have such a busy church that even as a pastor, it's difficult keeping up with all the things kind of going on. And then I look at the calendar and I kind of go, oh man, I've got to be at this. And I've, oh, that's right, you know, there's just a lot going on in this church, and things are really ramping up at this time of the year, and that's a good thing. Couple things that I do want to call your attention to that are not on the calendar, but that are very important to me, is that on March 6th, we're going to have a congregational gathering here in the sanctuary at 12 o'clock, and that's going to give the congregation, all members, an opportunity to come and to ask me questions. And so as you've probably heard, I've been selected by the call committee and have been recommended to the council, and they have voted for me to perhaps step into that lead pastor role if that is God's will and God is working through you and that becomes your will. And so I really want the opportunity, and I suggested this, I just want the opportunity to answer questions. And so you can bring your questions. Make sure that they're all very, very easy. I don't want any hard ones. one thing that I just want to say, and I know we got to get rolling here and keep moving with our service, but one thing I want to say, this is the question that comes up again and again and again. And you guys are probably all thinking it. What end of the church am I going to be on, right? That's the big question that seems to come up again and again to me. And I believe that the lead pastor needs to be equal at both ends of the church. And so there's going to be some movement back and forth going on. That's going to be natural if I become your lead pastor. And the associate pastor, likewise, will have a very equal role at both ends of the church. And in that way, there's equal exposure and equal pastoring. And I think that would be very, very healthy for our church as well, to have fresh faces up here in front of our congregation. That's a little understanding there. That's a question that I thought I would head off before that comes about. And then also on March 13th, which is the week following that, is the vote. And so please come and vote and be part of that. I appreciate that very much. And I just appreciate your prayer, your love, and your support. I understand that as a pastor now and having been a senior pastor before, I understand that that's a major responsibility, and I take it with fear and trembling. And ultimately, I want to please Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, first and foremost, by serving you in his love. So just bear that in mind, and I appreciate your prayers again. Altar flowers are given by Jackie Sexton in memory of her husband, Terry. And then also prayers for Lena and Gus Erickson and their family upon the passing of their son, Michael. So we just really appreciate, they really appreciate your prayers at this time. And I reached out to Lena earlier last week and had a conversation with her. Very difficult, as you can imagine. So with that, let's go ahead and prepare our hearts to enter into worship. Please stand.
We gather today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things that we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, and lead us that we may bathe in the glory of your Son, born among us, and reflect your love for all creation. Amen. Rejoice in the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. We are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life, live as freed and forgiven children of God. Be with you. And let us pray. O Lord Jesus, make us instruments of your peace, that where there is hatred, we may sow love, where there is injury, pardon, and where there is despair, hope. Grant, O Divine Master, that we may seek to console, to understand, and to love in your name. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our reading is from Psalm 37. Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret, it only causes harm. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait on the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be no more. Indeed, you will look carefully for his place, but it shall be no more. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. But the salvation of the righteous is from the Lord. He is their strength in the time of trouble. And the Lord shall help them and deliver them. He shall deliver them from the wicked and save them because they trust him. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? You foolish person, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. So is it with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown in natural body. It is raised in a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, and the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven, as was the man of dust. So also are those who are of the dust, and is the man of heaven. So also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have been born the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 6th chapter. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. To one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you. And from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is that to you? Even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind and ungrateful, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil, Be merciful, even as your Father is merciful. Judge not, and you will not be judged. Condemn not, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. It's quite a passage. You know, there's not a lot of love in the world. It seems that year by year, things grow a little bit more cruel. Jesus in Matthew 24 said that in the end times, the love of many or most would grow cold. And you can kind of see that taking place. As our country and as the world moves further and further away from the light of God, people become harder. I remember talking to my uncle years ago, and he spent a lot of time walking the streets of Seattle, and I remember him saying that, you know, people are so much harder today than they were years ago. They're just hard. And that's kind of what we entertain ourselves with, are hard people. Our music has become harder. And Jesus is addressing that in this sermon. In Luke chapter 6, verse 17, it gives us the context for this sermon. It says that, and he came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem. This right here, this passage is from Jesus' sermon on the plain. It's actually a different sermon than the one on the mount. The one on the mount took place in a different place. And this was on a level plain. And so it's a little different. It's kind of neat to compare the two. And you can see how Jesus is emphasizing some different things. He has the Beatitudes in this sermon, like he does in the sermon given to us in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, the Sermon on the Mount. But things are a little bit different. And even in this passage, he handles the love that we are to have for others a little differently. Although, There's a lot of likeness, too, between the Matthew account of the Sermon on the Plain. But Jesus is striking at the heart of humankind here. And he wants to have a changed people, a people that won't grow hard with the times, a people that will have soft hearts, kind hearts, filled with the loving kindness of God. So in verse 27, he says, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. This is really the high water mark of Jesus' teaching. It's about love. It really is. I mean, that's what it's all about. We talked about this last time I was here. We looked at 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and spent some time looking at that. That's literally what Jesus is all about. God is love. If you want something to describe, if you want a word, an understanding, a concept to really describe the character of God, who he is in himself, love sums it up. And he wants us to have the same kind of love that he has. And that's what Jesus is getting at here. Literally, he commands us to love our enemies, to love those who persecute us, to love those who harm us and hurt us. He's commanding us to love the unlovable people in our life. Verse 29, to one who strikes you, he gives some examples here, to one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you. And from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. This understanding of one who begs is not an individual in need. This is an individual that wants to take advantage of you. This could be a child that never really grows up and keeps asking for more, and you're so tired. I know of some boomerang kids that have come back to live, and they're still living with their parents, and they're in their 40s and 50s, and they're still living off of their parents. The world teaches this way, to beg and ask when you really don't need, to use the system, to use people. But what does Jesus command us to do? To continue to give. It's completely contrary to what we would think would be the right thing to do. Now, of course, this is a very broad, almost idyllic statement, and we have to look at things case by case. But again, we need to keep coming back to this understanding of Jesus's love and the love that he wants to put within us and the love that he displayed for us. I mean, how was Jesus? When Jesus was taken captive on the night when he was betrayed, how did he act when his abusers hit him in the face and abused him and tore out his beard and put a crown of thorns on his head? How did he respond? How did he respond when he was on the cross? He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He was still conducting his business of love, wasn't he? You have two thieves that were just hurling insults at him. And then finally, one thief felt humbled. And Jesus turns to him and didn't waste any time to save his soul from hell, even while he was nailed to the cross. It's remarkable. Jesus has a kind of love that we just do not see in the world. It's a higher kind of love. See, what Jesus wants to do in us is he wants to break the cycle of sin. And when we don't have love for others, we fall into this cycle of sin. There's a desire in each of us. There's a desire in each of us to repay evil for evil. It's just natural. We're all natural born boxers. And when somebody hits us in the face, we want to hit them back. Maybe not physically, but at least with words. Or maybe we'll be passive aggressive, something along those lines. Or maybe we'll give them the cold treatment or whatever it is. We want to get them back. Somebody cuts us off on the road. What do we want to do? Get in front of them or wish the best for them. Or man, I wish there was a cop around to pull that jerk over. What is it about us? You know, it's so funny because this tit for tat, this circular, that's exactly the way sin works. We see this in the Middle East. We see this all over the world. Things go around and around and around. What God wants to do is he wants to break this cycle of madness, of destruction, of hatred. And so if someone strikes us in the cheek, Jesus says, hold on a second. Don't strike him back. And watch what happens. You can disarm them. They're expecting you to strike back. But don't strike them back. Give God an opportunity to stand in the middle of that hatred. It's almost like when two people are fighting back and forth. How do you stand in the middle of them? How do you break them up? Well, if one gives and just turns his cheek and doesn't strike back, suddenly God can enter into that situation and begin his convicting, healing power. That's what God does. God wants to work his power. He wants to heal, and he wants to save us from destroying ourselves. When we hate our enemies, our hatred will ultimately destroy us. And some of you know what I'm talking about. You know, the classic movie Ben-Hur with Charlton Heston. What a tremendous example of this. It's one of my favorite films. He is so angry, and he's living off of hatred. And finally, at the end, the sword is taken out of his hand by Jesus, and he's set free from that hatred, that desire for vengeance. Because when we hate, and hate's a strange thing. You may not even realize you hate. You don't have to go through all of the emotions all the time. But it's that attitude of condemnation for another. What it does is it robs us of the freedom that Jesus came to give us so that we can live our lives in freedom. And ultimately, the way that we can be delivered of hatred and to experience the love of Christ in our life is to forgive. Forgiveness. Forgiveness is what it's all about. That's the first step to practice the love of Jesus Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I can't remember what verse, but it says the love of God controls us in the ESV. The love of God controls us. In the NIV, it says compels us. I like that too. We want the love of God to control and to compel us. That's what we desire. That's what we really want. And then we can experience freedom. But we must learn forgiveness. I was reading about Corrie Ten Boom. And she was in the Ravensbrück concentration camp and was finally set free. Just a remarkable story. I'm sure many of you know that story. I kind of grew up with it. But in 1947, she was at a church in Munich, and one of the prison guards who persecuted her sister died in the camp, came up to her after she had presented and gave her testimony, and he said, "Do you remember me?" He said, "I was a prison guard there, and I've become a believer. And I know the Lord has forgiven me. Do you forgive me?" And it took all Corrie Ten Boom's effort, and she cried out to God, "Please, give me the strength to forgive him." And God provided her with the strength, and she said, "When I was able to forgive, my hatred disappeared." "What a liberation," she writes, she says. "Forgiveness is the key that unlocks the door of resentment and the handcuffs of hatred." To forgive. Verse 31, "And as you wish that others would do to you, do to them. Do so to them." The golden rule, here it is. The great golden rule of Jesus Christ. There's the Golden Rule mosaic. I've never seen it. I would love to see it. It's based on the famous painting by Norman Rockwell at the United Nations headquarters complex in New York. And it features Jesus' version of the Golden Rule. See, there's Golden Rules all over the world. Socrates had a Golden Rule. Plato had a Golden Rule. Actually, Aristotle, Confucius had a Golden Rule. There's Golden Rules all over the place. Even ancient Egypt had a form of the Golden Rule. However, Jesus' golden rule is very unique. It lies at the center of all his teaching. Again, it illustrates the high watermark of his teaching to love. And Jesus' golden rule is different in that it's put in the positive form. Nearly all the other golden rules say something like, "Don't do to others what you don't want them to do to you." It's a way of protecting yourself. Jesus' golden rule is, "Do unto others as you would have them do unto you." It's active. It's not passive. It puts yourself to work. It's the kind of love that compels us, that Jesus is looking for to dwell in your heart and mine, to compel us to actually make a difference in the lives of those around us, to say, "I forgive you and I love you because Jesus Christ died for you on the cross." That's the golden rule that Jesus is talking about. Also, Jesus' golden rule is not only applied to your neighbor. Every single other golden rule that I've ever read is always applied to your neighbor, a friend, a family member, something along those lines. Jesus' golden rule is applied to somebody that is harming you and trying to kill you. It's like a whole different understanding. It's loving the unlovable in your eyes, the people that you would naturally hate. That's what the golden rule is being applied to here. It's remarkable. Jesus' love is one of action, and it knows no boundaries. Verse 32, "If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners do the same." Again, Jesus here is lifting the standard, and he says, and if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners and to get back the same amount. Jesus here is not saying that there's no benefit in loving those who love us back. I mean, I really enjoy being loved by my wife and kids. And I love them, and it's a super joy to be loved back. It's a super joy to be loved back by you. There's nothing wrong with that. But Jesus doesn't want us to miss out on a greater benefit, and that is to love those who don't love you back. He wants to lift us out of this transactional form of love. He wants us to love people that we're not going to get anything back from. And why is that such a benefit to us? Because there's a great reward in that. Verse 35 says, but love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. And that's exactly what we should be towards the unkind and the people that are ungrateful and evil around us. See, here's the deal. I think this is what Jesus is getting at, is that when we learn to love those individuals that don't return that love, it causes us to rely upon Jesus Christ. Think about that for a moment. When we love somebody, it's outgoing. We lose something. Something comes out of us. It could be an action. It could be giving of resources, time, energy, efforts, whatever. It always takes efforts. It could even be just emotional. But we're losing something. Something is outgoing and it's draining us when it's not returned. I know marriages that are falling apart where the spouse loves the other, but the other doesn't love, and there's just no return. And she's just soaking it up and draining and destroying the other. But we as believers can turn to Jesus Christ, and we can be empowered by him, and it causes us to rely upon him in a way that we would never rely upon him. It forces us to rely upon Jesus. And so then we become strengthened by him. That is our reward here and now. Now there's a future reward that I think Jesus is referring to as well. But we can experience a reward here and now. And that is relying upon Jesus, growing in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Because guess what? The only thing that we take with us to heaven is our relationship with Jesus Christ. We don't take our spouse. We don't take our favorite dog. We don't even take the clothes on our body, for heaven's sakes. We come into this world with nothing. We leave with nothing. Well, we can leave with our relationship with the Lord. And that relationship can be deepened as we rely upon him. And loving our enemies causes us to rely upon Jesus. Jesus can give us what others cannot. One of the first things that I say during premarital counseling is I said, you know, you're going to be tempted to try to get from your spouse what you can only get from God. Don't do it. Don't do it. Rely upon God. Draw from him. His power is endless. His love knows no end. He can put his agape love in you to empower you to love the unlovable. We ultimately want to become like our Heavenly Father. Romans 8:32 says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? If we're lacking love, he will give us that love. God is so willing to give us all things, and God wants to empower us to give our lives away to the other, because our life is ultimately in Christ. Jesus' commands here to love is not just some unattainable ideal. And sometimes that's the way we interpret these verses. Jesus doesn't command us things that we can't experience in our lives. He doesn't ask us to do the impossible with his help. It would be impossible on our own, for sure, but with him, all things are possible. Jesus is inviting us this morning to love with him. To love with him. To learn to love as he has loved us. I want to end with this quote from Dallas Willard. I'm sorry if the words are a little small there on the screens. I maybe we should have broke it down into two here. But Dallas Willard writes, "When Jesus hung on the cross and prayed, 'Father, forgive them because they do not understand what they are doing,' that was not hard for him. What would have been hard for him would have been to curse his enemies and spew forth vileness and evil upon everyone, God and the world, as those crucified with him did, at least for a while. He calls us to him to impart himself to us. He does not call us to do what he did, but to be as he was, permeated by love, permeated with love. Then the doing of what he did and said becomes the natural expression of who we are in him." Jesus is inviting every single one of us this morning to love as he has loved by relying upon him and his strength and his power. If we try to love the unlovable and forgive the unforgivable in our lives without his help, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Just like what Corrie Ten Boom experienced. She was given the power to love, to forgive. And she knew she didn't have that in herself by her own strength. God gave that to her in her hour of need. Let's call out upon the Lord. Let's be the people of God. Let's reflect our Heavenly Father and walk with Jesus. Let's love with Jesus. Lord Jesus, we come before you this morning. And we just thank you so much for this time together. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to learn to love and to love with you, to be with you. Jesus, we ask that you would pour your love into our hearts, that when we come across situations and people in our lives, people that have tremendously hurt us or family members or people we love, and it's difficult for us because we feel in ourselves an unwillingness to forgive, and even feelings of hatred and condemnation, I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that you would convict our hearts, that you would step into our lives and empower us to be the people you've called us to be. Lord Jesus, we want to be freed from the shackles of hatred and condemnation. We want to be filled with the freedom that you've come to give us through your cross, through your resurrection. Bless you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Please stand.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, let us profess our faith in the creed for the Epiphany season. I believe in God, the creator of the universe, who spoke, "Let there be light," and there was light, setting in motion all of creation and blessing it to this day. I believe in Jesus Christ, the light of the world, that shines in the darkness. The darkness cannot overcome it. He embodied humanity in kindness, truthfulness, humility, and devotion. He suffered for a greater good. He was and is the Son of God. He died on the cross for us. God's saving grace delivered him from the bonds of death. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the guiding light of God in our world. Through his Spirit, God penetrates and reveals the darkness of human sin, helps people grow and become the people they are meant to be. I believe in the power of transformation through God's Spirit and light here in this world and the world to come. Amen. Joining our hearts and minds, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Most High God, we cannot open our hands and hearts to receive your many blessings when we clench our fists in anger, judging one another as unworthy. And so, we ask you to replace our stony hearts with new hearts that are cleansed and filled with your Spirit. Your word says that it is through the power of Jesus' blood that we have been forgiven. Therefore, we have the duty to forgive others even when we don't feel like it. Instill in us the desire to honor you through acts of mercy and love. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, please provide comfort and support for Lena and Gus Erickson and their family as they grieve the loss of their son, Michael. We pray for the hearts of mothers and fathers everywhere whose children have been lost. We lift them in silent, heartfelt prayer at this time. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of every nation, tribe, and tongue, there have always been wars and rumors of wars. So we pray for all who work for peaceful solutions to the world's problems. We ask you to spoil the plans of evil men and extinguish the fires of malice and hate that's in their hearts. As you grace us, help us to be gracious in our dealings with others, regardless of how they treat us. As much as it depends on us, help us to live at peace with everyone. Lord, in your mercy. God of mercy, come quickly to us with grace upon grace as we lift these and all our prayers to you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and our duty and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name. In the night in which our Lord was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And after he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness
of your sins, do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. May the Spirit bless us and these elements as we pray the prayer that the Lord taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.